Seminary professor Tony Campolo tells of the Baptist church that he attended in Philadelphia that celebrates their graduates each year. And on one particular graduate recognition Sunday, a few of the graduates of the congregation led the service through the call to worship and scripture reading, and then the preacher stood up to preach. Young men and women, he proclaimed, you are going to die. You may not think you're going to die, but one of these days they're going to take you down to the cemetery, drop you in a hole, throw some dirt on you, go back to the church and eat potato salad. Not exactly a rousing graduation send-off, though I understand his point. He is absolutely correct, as the death rate still hovers somewhere around 100%. I've been thinking about my own mortality recently. Perhaps it is because now, solidly in my 60s, I am way past the halfway mark. The wrinkles are more pronounced, the skin not so tight. Perhaps it is because life seems to be sprinting by. Didn't we celebrate Christmas just last Thursday? Whatever the reason, I find myself thinking more about mortality, about death, about the end. And I wonder what it will be, cancer, a heart attack, an accident, old age. Where will I be and who will be with me? And what will it be like to be gone? And yes, who will have to clean out my closets? I wonder if it will matter that I have lived. Will I have given my one shot at life everything I've got? Because once it is over, there are no mulligans, and then the potato salad. Death is so final, or so it seems. This morning on this All Saints Sunday, Arlene read the account of Moses' death. Moses, one of our saints, whose story actually begins centuries before his birth with Abraham and Sarah, with whom God made a covenant, a promise of a great nation with their own flowing with milk and honey land, and that through them the whole world would be blessed. But Abraham and Sarah did not live long enough to see the promise fulfilled. And their story continues in Isaac and Rebecca, who did not make it to the promised land either. Their story picks up in Jacob and Rachel, whose story then continues in Joshua. And by the time Joshua dies, not only are they not living large in the promised land, the Hebrew people are living in Egypt as slaves. The storyline continues generation to generation, and they spend the next 400 years on Egyptian building projects, no promised land, a dream gone forever. And then comes Moses. Hidden in a basket, adopted by an Egyptian princess, a murderer, a 40-year fugitive, the burning bush, and God taps him to lead the Jewish people out of bondage in Egypt to the long-ago promised land to Abraham. Promised to Abraham and Sarah. The Exodus, the parting of the Red Sea, manna, quail, the golden calf, 10 commandments. 40 years of wandering the desert longing for the promised land. And now it is almost over. They are nearly home. And it comes down to this final chapter in Deuteronomy. Moses, now a very old man, hikes up Mount Pisgah. From that vantage point, God shows him the whole sweep of the promised land, and it is a take-your-breath-away view. Look, Moses, over there, Gilead and Naphtali, the Negev, as far as the eye can see, all the way to the Valley of Jericho. There it is, Moses. Centuries ago, I promised all this land to your ancestors, Abraham and Sarah. Isn't it beautiful? Moses, you are seeing it with your very own eyes, but you will not go there. Your part of the story is done. Joshua will take the baton. I imagine Moses' response this way: you mean I spent the last 40 years doing just what you asked? 40 years of pursuing the promised land? 40 years of manna stew, manna burgers, manna pie? 40 years of my people's incessant whining, and I don't get one little taste of milk and honey? Now, we really do not know what went on in the mind and heart of Moses. We are told only that Moses, servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab. It is over. Bring on the potato salad. He's dead, and death is so final. Or so it seems. After 30 days, the period of mourning for Moses ends. But his story picks up again in the next verse. We read, Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him, and the Israelites obeyed Joshua, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Because of the investment Moses has made in Joshua, his story does not end. It continues. The one who will lead the people into the promised land. And the story does not end there either. The job was still not finished. There was this whole world that was still to be blessed. And so Joshua hands off the baton that passes through the hands of Boaz and Ruth, of Jesse and King David. David gives that baton to Solomon, and then it passes through the hands of Jehoshaphat and Uzziah, Zerubbabel and Eleazar. And one day Jesus himself receives it. But even then, the work would not be finished. Even Jesus dies before the promise is fulfilled. He passes the baton, his legacy of love and grace, to Peter and to Mary Magdalene and the Apostle Paul. It is picked up by St. Augustine, Teresa of Avila, John Calvin, Rosa Parks. Generation to generation, person to person, the baton is passed. And it is in our hands now. When it is over, there may indeed be potato salad, but it is not over. The ripple effect of one life, of one generation, for good or for ill, spills over into the next. And our Christian faith invites us to understand that our lives did not begin with us, neither do they end with us. We inherited the legacy passed to us and to our children, and theirs will inherit the world we will pass to them. The seventh generation principle is shared by many American Indian cultures. It goes like this. When the chiefs deliberate on serious matters before the council, they are to consider the impact of their decisions seven generations into the future. And so they proceed carefully, thoughtfully, lovingly, thinking of the effect their decisions will have on the well-being of those who will carry on the story once they are gone. They understand the ripple effect of one life, of one generation, for good or for ill, spills over to the next, and the next, and the next. On this All Saints Sunday, we take time to remember those who have passed the baton to us. It is a relay that stretches far back into the past, and we honor those who have gone before us for their faith, for the ways that their lives show us the way to live. We remember, too, that we are saints in the making, that the story of our own families, our own church, began before we showed up, includes us for a few years, and will go on after us, after our potato salad. We consider our own lives and think about what difference it will make that we have lived, the impact of our choices, whether our time with a baton will give or take, build up or tear down, help or hinder God's dream. And that whatever went on before, we are responsible for what we do with the baton when it is in our hands. Because when we are gone, it is not over. We set the stage for at least 7 generations to come. In almost every church and cathedral that Gary and I visit on our travels, we stop to light a candle or two. Most often I light a candle in memory of or gratitude for someone who, for me, has been a saint. Someone who, one way or another, handed the baton on to me, whose life I would want to emulate. And on this All Saints morning, I would like us to do the same. To call to mind those who have graced our lives and moved on to the life to come. And then to light a candle of remembrance and gratitude. In just a moment, you will be invited to come forward to light a candle. This morning, we're not going to do that in any particular order. Just come as you are ready to do so. The idea is this: to remember and honor someone who handed you the baton, whose investments in your life mattered. And so I invite you now to take a moment and name in your heart someone whose presence in your life was precious and important. Someone whose ways and faith inspire your own. And then when you are ready, and only if you wish, come forward from the center aisle to take your place. You can circle the table this morning. Light a candle, offer a quiet prayer of gratitude for the preciousness of that life, and then return to your seat by the side aisle. Come now, as you wish.